going to get to grips with this clicker now. Hi, I'm Lizzi Hollis. I'm a fundraising officer at Independent Age, and we are an older people's charity. I'm going to use my 9 minutes to talk to you about why I think the future success of the fundraising sector is getting to know our supporters and what we can do to achieve this. First of all, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. So this picture of me was taken 15 miles into the Brighton Marathon. I totally did not look this chipper afterwards. A few things about me. I like to cycle. I cycle almost every day. I'm a volunteer for a small football charity called Football Beyond Borders. I'm recently engaged and getting married next year. I absolutely love to bake. I bake constantly. I'm really into pop punk music and emo music, so I still listen to the exact same things I did when I was 16. And I'm also softball captain of the Independent Rage softball team. And we unfortunately lost our first game of the season last night. It's a bit of a bummer. But enough about me. I don't need to tell you lot that the sector has had a difficult year, and we also know that it isn't over yet. So we haven't got the details of the fundraising preference service. Well, as long as the Daily Mail thinks that there's public interest for it, all of our actions will be scrutinised, and the shock of Brexit still hasn't hit us, and we don't know how it's going to affect the fundraising sector. But, as fundraisers, we are eternally optimistic people, and we will bounce back from this. But actually, what's clear to me is that our personal relationships, or at least the illusion of bespoke, tailor-made personal relationships, are more important than ever. So over 22.1 million people in the UK give to charity in some capacity. So actually you can see how we've just become a little bit mercenary in the way that we talk to our supporters. How on earth do we make half of the UK population feel like they are the most important person to our charity? Well actually, to me it's simple. We get to know our donors. We build relationships and we tailor our communications based on our findings. So let me give you an example. In 2014, my charity stepped up a long-standing partnership with home care nursing company Prestige Nursing and Care, and the fit was absolutely perfect. So the majority of their beneficiaries are older people, so they're clued into the issues. They have a staff base of around 44 different UK locations, and they had a track record of working with charities. So it should have been a match made in heaven. But year one was an absolute disaster. They were pledged to raise £40,000 and instead they barely raised £3K. Okay, so why did this happen? It's because we didn't know them. So when I arrived at Independent Age in 2015, I made it my goal to turn the partnership around. And I did this in one very simple way. I got to know them. I met with the MD, I made friends with the marketing manager, I wormed my way into the good graces of the regional managers, and I visited branches. So between July and September last year, I went to every corner of England galvanizing staff. Those I couldn't meet, I spoke to via email, on the telephone, and I set up conference calls. I put bulletins in staff newsletters, and I also put things on the intranet. Basically, I was as energised and as annoyingly charming as I could possibly be. And from this I learned. I learned although having over 3,000 staff, the majority of these were mobile or bank staff, and they weren't really engaged with the company, let alone the charities that they supported. Some offices barely have 3 full-time members of staff, and I also learned that they were incredibly busy people. They didn't have time for their own workloads. I learned that asking each branch to raise £1,000 in a day was almost impossible for everyone. So I scrapped that idea, completely got rid of it, and instead I decided to tailor the partnership. I gave them a longer lead time, I gave them more time to fundraise, and I didn't dictate to them how they raised the money. I just let them do it, and I supported them in those endeavours. And the result, I hear you ask? £10,000 and another year's partnership. Now, I know you're not all corporate fundraisers, and I know that we can't get face-to-face with our donors all the time. But actually, the key point here is exactly the same. No matter what sort of fundraiser you are, to be successful and to ensure the futures of our charities, we have to make our supporters think that we know who they are, and we have to tailor our relationships accordingly. It'll take some work, but we can use demographic classifications to segment our donor base, and here's a couple of examples. Meet Sandra. She's 69 and she's recently retired. She has three grown-up daughters, we're currently looking at one of them, and she enjoys travelling. She goes abroad about three times a year, which aforementioned daughter is pretty jealous about. She has a very broad social circle. She enjoys socialising, down the pub on a Friday night, but she's not really much of an organiser. She likes crafting, she goes shopping in Marks and Spencer. She didn't go to university, but before spending over 30 years working for the local council in sheltered housing, she was a nurse. She doesn't own her own home, she doesn't know any high net worth individuals in her close social circle. And here's Yui. He's 32, he's getting married next week. He's a young homeowner, he enjoys cycling, brewing his own beer, going to pubs, not clubs. He likes spending time with his friends and family and watching Netflix. If any one of us met Sandra or Ewan in the street, we'd more than likely change the way that we interact with each other just by looking at them. So why on earth are we not building our relationships in the same way? The key difference between the two is the supportive journey that we offer. We know that Ewan is a young professional with a keen interest in active pursuits and a good social networks, and we know that his demographic are less likely to make a regular donation. We also know that males less frequently take part in mass participation events, so we may initially engage him in a sponsored challenge. Sandra, on the other hand, is retired, and she's got good social networks. So because of her age, we might immediately jump to legacy marketing or a mass participation event. However, from getting to own Sandra, we know that she doesn't own her own home, so she probably doesn't have many assets to give away. And while she has a strong social network, we also know that she's not an organiser. The best way to engage Sandra might be through a one-off direct mail appeal, or asking her to give her time without asking her to organise, so perhaps a bucket collection. Now, let me bring you back to this earlier slide. So you can see that I'm a volunteer, so I'm engaged with the sector. You know that I'm active, and you know that I have a good social life. So perhaps I'm looking at this, even for your own charities, the cogs are working as to how you might engage me with your charity. What you don't know about me, though, is that although I ran the Brighton Marathon, I hated absolutely every moment of it, regardless of how happy I look in this photograph. Even though you know that I'm a volunteer and I'm a fundraiser, can you actually make the same assumptions about your own volunteers and what their day jobs are? Because I'm so busy, I value my free time to sit down and read a book, or watch the football, or watch a box set. So actually, my free time is really important to me. And it's vital for us as fundraisers to ensure we know or can make assumptions as to who our donors are and make them feel valued with our causes and ask questions where we can. In an ever more difficult climate, with the fundraising regulatory body making more stringent demands of us and the potential damage of opt-in communications, it's going to be harder than ever for us to hang on to our donors and keep delivering our vital services. The way we build relationships and maintain them is key to everything that we do. And we need to work together to ensure this. So let's think about, for example, how we store our information and how we use our databases. So do you guys have a robust CRM system within your organizations so you can store accurately the key attributes of your supporters? And if you do, how do you communicate this amongst your teams? If your database is neat and tidy, you need to make sure that your internal processes are in place so that accessing information is easy too. You need to use your CRM systems to do something like taking under course of insight gathering. So whether you're looking to set up your next corporate partnership, or you're sending out your next fundraising appeal, or perhaps you're recruiting for a mass participation event, or looking for individuals to run the marathon, make sure you know who you're talking to and that your relationships are robust enough to actually be successful in your asks. Individualism and the idea of identity is one of the biggest trends in our society. I've just done the wrong bit. Let me start again. So make sure you think, what would Sandra or you would respond to? What are your other demographics? What does Shelley, Lucy, Bob, Dorothy, or John want? And how can we as fundraisers give them that and also get something in return? Individualism and the idea of identity is one of the biggest trends in our society. From selfie culture to personality politics, people want to be inspired and they want to be motivated. They also want to feel special. And as charities, we have to recognise that, or we risk getting left behind. So when you're prepping for your next direct mail, or volunteer ask, or corporate fundraising approach, don't think, what is this person, or this group, or this company going to do for our charity? But what can we offer this person, or this group? Taking this approach and understanding our donors will result in far more long-term fruitful support. Thank you very much. Yeah.